ओके
हेलो, आई एम सौंदरम रामनाथन. आई वर्क विद द सेंटर फॉर साइंस एंड एनवायरनमेंट एंड आई एम पार्ट ऑफ द इंडस्ट्री पोल्यूशन यूनिट एट द सेंटर. लास्ट 6-7 इयर्स आई हैव बीन एसोसिएटेड विद कंट्रोलिंग पोल्यूशन फ्रॉम कोल बेस्ड थर्मल पावर प्लांट्स. And today we'll be seeing how coal-based thermal power plants are one of the biggest source of pollution in cities, and it's contributing to the particulate matter load in cities, and how and what needs to be done, and how to integrate them with the Clean Air Action Plan. Now, all of us know there is solid fuel, liquid fuel, and gaseous fuel, and solid fuel is the dirtiest. So that's why, you know, when in the cooking atmosphere, you don't want to burn wood, wooden stoves and all, you don't want, and natural gas came into picture. So obviously coal is a solid fuel and it's dirty, and everyone acknowledges. When you burn coal, you generate particulate matter, sulfur dioxide, oxides of nitrogen. So these are three major pollutants which coal burning generates. And these three pollutants, they travel up to 300 kilometers. Like, you might think that, you know, imagining a coal-based power plant, maybe if it is inside your city, you might think, oh, it's polluting and I need to design something to control pollution. It's not so. Even if there is a coal power plant which is located 300 kilometers away from your city in any radius, scientists have studied that it can affect your city. How? Like, if you see the dust, yes, the dust control measures are there always in power stations. The sulfur dioxide and oxides of nitrogen, today there's no, you know, control measure. And these are gases, and the gases are not just going to remain as gases. They'll be converting into different particulates. Like, they react. They react to form some form of, you know, another particle or some form of dust. And that we call it secondary particulates. And when the scientist was studying what is the source of pollution, and you must have come across many new terms, source apportionment studies, etc. So there is so one is, you know, what are the sources, and then you calculate what is the load and what could have come into your atmosphere. And the second way to see what is the pollutant and from where it has come into your atmosphere is by taking some dust sample and doing some chemical analysis of it and seeing what are the components, chemical tracing, and then finding out what is, like, you know, the pollution or from what is the source. And when they did that kind of analysis, what they found was, nearly in Delhi, if you take the particulate matter and if you analyze what are the components of the dust, 40% is just sulfates. And in Kanpur, it is 15%. In Vadodara, this is 20%. So these are all old studies. Okay. Delhi is the recent one. This is from Gujarat and this is Kolkata. This is tremendous. Sulfates. And there's no particular source which is generating sulfates in these cities. Okay. That's just like, you know, if you build a construction unit, you might get sand, that's silicates. But how do sulfates come into your ambient air? Even you and I today have shifted to BS6 fuel. Petrol, you know, is we are trying to reduce as much as possible sulfur from our petrol and diesel. And but this very peculiar, then from where it's coming. But if you see similar particulate matter, if you take out and then you analyze the components in US and Europe, you will see less than 1%. So that is how polluting coal is. Even if the demon is not in your city, it's there. And this, I am helping Air Pollution Unit, Ms. Priyanka Chandola, who is organizing this program. Her unit works on preparing these plans and we contribute to them. When I analyze, so far I have helped them in some states, in Andhra, Odisha, West Bengal, and Rajasthan. We have worked with them. And typically, whenever I see there is, like, whichever non-attainment cities it is, like Srikakulam or Vishakhapatnam, Kakinada, Rajahmundry, wherever, like just 60 kilometers from there, 100 kilometers from there is a power plant. And if you go to that particular person, and if you say, like, if you go to Kadapa person and you say, you know, the Rayalaseema TPP is affecting you, he's finding it hard to believe. He says it's a different district. It doesn't even come into my territory. Why will I go tell them you're polluting and you're sending your smoke here? How do I believe? It might be hard to believe, but that's the truth. Like, if you see West Bengal, whichever non-attainment city, and nearby, if you see, there'll be a bunch of coal power plants. So coal power plants believe it is a source of pollution. And so far, we have not taken cognizance of it because it was not in as many numbers as it is today. But something has to be done to control pollution from them. So till now, if you see the ministry and the Central Pollution Control Board, so they are the regulators for controlling pollution. And they set emission limits. They set norms. After this, you shouldn't be emitting into air. So earlier, there was limits for dust, how much dust you can emit into the atmosphere. But there was no limits for sulfur dioxide or oxides of nitrogen. There was only limits for particulate matter. But the government has been taking cognizance that TPP sector is expanding and there should be limits set, because if it goes into atmosphere, it's obviously going to turn up into, you know, all the sulfates which we were discussing earlier, and it's going to affect us. So immediately it did not come with limits. Okay, so it's hard, right? It's not like demonetization, like tomorrow I'll say that 500 notes are not going to work. So they've been in talks under the corporate environment responsibility program with the industry, saying, you know, boss, now we are all expanding, too many power plants that are coming up. So, you know, till from our independence till 2010, maybe, you had only 100,000 megawatt of coal power capacity in India. Now, after 2010 or 11, till now, that is between 2011 to 17, whatever we did after independence, that 60 years, we just had constructed so many power plants in just the 7 years. That was a massive expansion. Like in what we have done in 60 years, if we could do it in just 6 years now, right? So they have been in talks with the sector. They are saying that we'll be introducing new norms to cover SO2 and NOx. And the industry themselves volunteered and they said, yeah, we are prepared. So that went on from 2003 for 7 years. And then in 2015, new limits were introduced for sulfur dioxide and oxides of nitrogen. And they tightened the particulate matter norms. Now, this was in the limits were introduced in 2015. And there was a deadline which was set that by 2017, you have to meet these limits. But in reality, what is happening is, except few major players like NTPC and Adani, most of the plants in the sector are pushing back. They don't want to do it. So if you ask me, what is this limit? Now, this is the limit. So if you see a coal power generating unit, they are of different sizes also, and they are installed at various time periods. So this norms which the government has come up with has come after extensive consultations with different stakeholders, and they've done independent studies. So they have taken into consideration that they don't want to invest a lot into old power plants. So they have kept the norms little lenient for the older fleet. And those installed between 2004 and 16, they have somewhat a little tighter norms. And the latest ones, they have a very tight, like the PM for an old plant will be 100 in India, but those between 2004 and 16 will be 50, and the new ones it's 30. Similarly, the smaller size unit, sulfur dioxide is relaxed, and for the bigger ones it's 200. And NOx, similarly, it is 600 for the older ones and 300 for the ones installed between 2004 and 16. This got revised recently to 450. Now, these are reasonably comparable to global benchmarks, though now the entire world is moving against coal and they're introducing more tighter norms. But for India, it is more or less reasonable. And if you see, China has introduced even tighter norms. So we are at 100. They're saying even 10 mg you shouldn't emit into the atmosphere. Okay, 10 mg per cubic meter. And sulfur dioxide is 35 mg per cubic meter of air. Now, in the ambient air, what you can breathe, if you compare, this is, you can breathe 50 microgram per meter cube. That's what you can breathe in. But what, see what a power plant is emitting. Okay, for those of you who have not seen a power plant, this is how the smoke is going to be. Worse than your crackers or anything, yeah. So the basic assumption, or while introducing the norms, the benefits which they thought was, if you implement this norm, there will be a massive water use cut. Water norms are also introduced. Power plants are a big source of their water guzzlers. They almost take in 50% of all the drinking water which we guys are, drinking today. So much water power plants need to generate power today in India. So the ministry even introduced specific water norms. That is how much you can consume to generate 1 unit of electricity. Now that also has been that will be cut massively if power plants follow. Particulate matter also there will be a slight cut. Sulfur dioxide, since it's the first time, extreme cuts, and oxides of nitrogen too. Now, by cutting all these pollution, you can avoid 3 lakh deaths. Okay, so whatever money you're investing into these pollution control equipment, you're getting more benefits than what you're investing. So these are studies by other agencies also. C-STEP, NGO has done the study. Now, what it means to implement the norm, right? I know that 100 has to be met, 50 has to be met. So how do I meet it? So if you go to a power plant, so you will see a lot of equipment, and this which you see, right, after a boiler. So this is a boiler in a power plant, and after that you will see some a cylindrical shape equipments. This is called the electrostatic precipitators. In more or less all the power stations you find these equipment. So the power plants must install this, and they should be of appropriate, the latest technology and of the right size to take in the dust and filter everything, and then just leave the clean air. So basically, it is a dust filtration unit. And this, unlike what we use, like an air purifier, like in ACs, you use a strip of paper, right, through which a membrane paper through which the air comes out. But here, it will be like more electrodes. Which will be there, which will there will be electricity passing in, and it will attract the dust, and then that's how it is removed. Now, for a lay person, they can go into the control room and they can see this kind of a circuit layout also, which are available these days. So you can see the different electrostatic precipitator, at what pressure it is going in, what temperature it is going in, the flue gas, what is the dust concentration outside, what it is coming. So all these are available, and it should be displayed on the computers if you go to a power plant as a regulator. So that is about electrostatic precipitators. Now coming to sulfur dioxide, we had three pollutants, right? So sulfur dioxide you can control by reducing sulfur in the fuel, or by injecting some chemical solutions after you burn the coal in the tubes itself while it is passing. Or like this unit, which you see an electrostatic precipitator kind of a filtration unit, you can install one big scrubber here, and from in that you can pump in liquids, and then you can also clean the gas. So these are three ways you can do it. Now, basically, I'm assuming the audience is mostly the regulators, the government officials. So if you go to a power plant, you should ask them what is the sulfur in your coal, and what is the calorific value in your coal. So if you have these two numbers, then you can understand and estimate what should be the sulfur dioxide emission from the plant. And then if there is no control measure, this is going to be the emission. If they have a control measure, then 90 or 80% cut is obviously going to happen. Then you can assume, you can see whether it is meeting what the government has asked for or not. Now, in terms of treatment systems, if it is near a seawater plant, there is a new scrubbing system called seawater-based FGD. There it is just seawater and then you spray and you remove it. You remove the sulfur particle as gypsum. That is because seawater in itself has some alkalinity, which is capable of taking the sulfur in the fuel. Okay, sulfur is an acid and alkaline in the seawater. So acid and alkaline mix in some salt, which is gypsum coming out. Now, in the wet system, you pump in limestone to take out the sulfur dioxide. In dry system, you don't take a lot of water. You just observe and you spray it. So this is a comparison of wet and dry FGD system. So what the commercial range from what it starts and what are the types which are there and how much it can remove. What will be the sorbent use? Sorbent is the liquid you spray to remove the sulfur dioxide. What is the water consumption which will be needed if this has to happen? What will be the power consumption? Because you're pumping the liquid into it, right? So how much power consumption will happen? 0.7% means whatever the power plant is generating, out of that 0.7% will go to this particular equipment. And whether the chimney has to be modified or not, because when you pass the gas through this particular device, it is water, obviously the temperature will come down. If the temperature comes down, then the gas traveling from the bottom to the top is going to get difficult. If it's hot air, it will travel up. But if it is little watery air, how will it travel up? So that has to be seen. And what kind of byproduct, if sulfur dioxide is removed, it should get converted into some form, right? So how it is going to get converted and what is going to come out of it. And this typically, what is the space which is required if that FGD has to be installed in your unit? So typically 0.6 to 2.2 acres. And if it's a big unit, then you will need up to 7 acres for construction of this. Now, FGD unit is basically, you will have a scrubber, which is the main portion. And then you will have a whatever temperature it has to go in the flue gas. So whether that is, if that is not of that obvious temperature, then you will have a reheater. And then the ducting and lining of all the materials which are used, because it's hot gas and, it can corrode. So the material and how much time it takes is typically 18 months. So, if you see, if right now, since the government has announced this norm that you have to meet the sulfur dioxide limit, which means they have to have some equipments like this, at least in this much capacity, they will need such equipments, new equipments, which has to come for controlling particulate matter. Already there is equipment in all the power plants in India, which is the electrostatic precipitator. Now, similarly, to control sulfur dioxide, a new unit is required, which is FGD, in most power plants, and at least big power plants. So they are supposed to comply. They are not complying right now. So as regulators, you will need to ask them that they better comply. All right. So as a regulator, when you go there to see whether they're complying or not, you need to ask them, what is your plan of compliance? Because, this equipment to set up itself, it will take 24 months. All right. So 24 months means they have to have every month what I do. It is not like after 2 years, they come to tell you, we didn't do it because there was a problem here. There was a problem. At least the regulator should have a detail on where the process is right now. Okay, so this is a timeline which you must be knowing. If you want to make a project, you should do some feasibility study and you should have a detailed project report what and where I'm going to do. Then you have to prepare a notice inviting tender that I have to, construct this particular equipment. I need people to come and construct. Then you have to select a person. Then that person will come and he'll make a more detailed engineering report. Yahan pe ye aayega, I have to put one tube here and tweaking and everything. And then based on this engineering report, they have to get the equipment. And after the equipment come, they have to erect it. And after the erection happens, they have to test the performance and guarantee. So this is typically the schedule. And you should understand as a regulator in which stage they are, whether they are in the middle or they're in the basic stage, and whether it will happen or not. Now the third parameter, the third pollutant which is coming out is NOx, oxides of nitrogen. Now again, this can also be done to, at two stages. One is like if you modify the burner system itself, then you can control NOx. Now NOx is something, so sulfur is something, even at a lower temperature, the molecules react and you get sulfur dioxide. All right, so whatever the fuel has sulfur, even if you burn it at 900 degree or you burn it at 1000 degree, no, it doesn't make any difference, it will form. But NOx is something which will form if the temperature is very high. Fuel also gets converted, but it is the temperature which is a key factor which is making these oxides of nitrogen. All right. Otherwise, even we have nitrogen in air, it doesn't become NOx. Right. It's the temperature which is playing the factor. Now, one is you modify the burner itself, which is burning, so that the temperature, you know, you can play with and you control it. And the next thing you can do is you can treat the flue gas in which the NOx itself is going to come. Now, when you treat the flue gas, you can do it with a SCR, with a catalyst, you can do it without a catalyst. It's basically a reduction, right? Sulfur oxide of nitrogen, you have to reduce it to nitrogen. So it's reduction. But this is more advanced. We are not going into this. We are still, you know, fighting to do this burner modification. Now, if you go to a power plant, these are things you can see to see, you know, it's a burner. Obviously, in a power plant, if you see the burner size, to go back. Sorry. So this is a power plant. And in this, the burner itself will be till here. It will be like in a flat, it will be like three floors of burner in a power plant, okay? And what is hanging above is the boiler. So five floors of boiler and three floors of burner. That's how it will look. And it will be burning a lot of coal in this, some 100 tons an hour. So in this, you will have at each floor, you will have one oil pump, one coal pump. Because when you start burning, right, you can't start burning with the coal itself. Coal will not catch fire so fastly. So you have to put some oil, spray some oil. First, the oil catches fire and then slowly the coal will start catching fire. So you have to see whether it is a these you will see in the like in this computer screen in their control room about the configuration which they have. And you even if you don't make a site inspection from this, you can understand whether they're having the necessary burner modification done or not. By looking at this, so this is primary airflow, and here you see this is the secondary airflow. And if you see this more, then that means they have a better burners system, and they have a third generation or fourth generation system, and they're doing it right. Or this the second option could be you go to the chimney and then you measure it. So here you have to insert probes and you have to check whether the NOx is coming right, whether it is less or not. Now, how to make an action plan? Now, to make an action plan for this sector for thermal power plants, you have to understand the major action which needs to be taken in a power plant, whether the power plant is meeting the norms, NOx norms, whether it is meeting the particulate matter norm or the sulfur dioxide norm, whichever norm the government has set, whether they are meeting it or not. You should first understand that. If you can understand that by your own inspection, well and good, or you take along with you some sector experts, and then you understand what is happening in the plant and what are the equipments they have and what needs to be done. then ask the sub activities. If something is in progress already right there, then you ask them what are the different sub activities they will be doing, and then what is going to be the time which they will take to complete them. And then you inspect at least on a quarterly basis, 4 months once. Go there and see if it is happening or not, or you know if there is any tweaks. And if it is just a reasoning, and you know they're just voluntarily they're doing the failure. Now to give you an example, if you see in Delhi, there are near Delhi there are many coal power plants, and they were given a particular time frame by which they have to meet the norms, because you know Delhi about the pollution in Delhi in winters. So they were asked to early comply. But if you see the state generating plants, they come up and they say, you know, boss, it's very difficult to implement. We did give out the tenders, but nobody is responding to the tenders. See, we have re-tendered twice or thrice. Okay, it might sound to you, maybe, you know, one time they did it. Okay, they didn't get the vendors. Second time they did it, they didn't get the vendors. But after a point, when they do that kind of delay for 1 or 2 years, then you start thinking, why are they saying something like this? Because the rest of the power plants like Sasan or NTPC, they're able to give out tenders. Then you go and see what mechanism they follow. And you can even ask the manufacturers who are making those equipment, why is that you're not bidding for their tenders? And then they tell you different reasons. They say, you know, they are very complex. You can't bid. They try to put you into spot, and it's hard. Their balance sheet is bad. So they have different reasons for why they don't go and bid there. So typically what NTPC or some bigger firm I see doing is they call the vendors. They sit with them. They talk. They talk multiple times. They both come into some kind of terms. And then they leave a tender, and then they ask people to come and bid for it, so that you know you get the confidence of the vendors also, that you know these people are sound and they will help us and that can be done. And then they get people to work for them. So if you keep on saying that there are no people to work for you and that's why the norms are getting delayed, then there's some problem. So you have to see whether the reasoning is whatever reason they're giving for delay is right or wrong, and you have to design a strong deterrence mechanism to stop it. So I'm just giving you an example. This is Mejia Thermal Power Station. Now the power plant has 4 units of 210 megawatt and 2 units of 250 megawatt. So in a power plant, there is not just one burning unit. There are multiple burning units. And then I give them a first step will be, you know, you have to collect a milestone or a Gantt chart, how they will implement this and how they're going to implement their water norms, etc. And I set a time frame. I say, you know, they have to do it in 2 months or 3 months. You have to come and give me the plan. And then I prepare an action for monitoring at regular intervals. I say, you know, but this particular work should be done, the tendering work. Otherwise, I'll collect X percentage of your project cost as a fine or a bank guarantee amount if you don't do it by time, at least twice or thrice, you know. And then I give them this warning and I tell them, you know, you should complete this work by the then and then dates, and I finalize that by some time. And then I collect bank guarantee. I collect engineering documents, feasibility study, whether they're doing or not. If there is any default, then the bank guarantee goes away. Otherwise, the bank guarantee is returned. And then I see if the tenders are getting awarded by a certain date, whether the civil construction works begin in certain dates. I told you it's a scrubber unit and you need to install equipment. So obviously the longest will be, you know, the basement works, which is going to happen. If it is just about setting up a machine there, it's not going to take time. Like you buy a washing machine or a TV to your house, you just keep it out there, right? But here it is about building a basement, so it's going to take some time. So that, and then after that works get over, then you see whether the performance guarantee is done by a particular date. Now the worst part is to manage excuses. Now they'll go to any degree to give you excuses as to why this should not happen. And even the norms are wrong. If they can't meet, you know, if they don't want to work, they'll give you all sorts of excuses. So I'm just giving you some excuses they've been giving since, you know, 2015. One was, they said, oh, you know, if we start buying new equipment and install, it's going to be, your power cost is going to shoot up like anything. You know, your cost will go up by 1 rupee, your cost will go up by 2 rupee. Now, that sounds very absurd, because if you see the power cost in India, you have two components to it. One is the fixed cost and the second is the variable cost. Now, the beauty of it is, fixed cost means whatever the cost which is paid, whatever the cost which is agreed by the government, saying that, yes, you know, in India, we don't have power plants. We need power plants in India. So you install it and I give you guarantee for 25 years, I'll buy power from you. Even if I don't buy power from you for this 25 years, I will reimburse your whatever the fixed investment you put for building this power plant back to you. Now, that's like, and that too with a return. Okay, that's like I'm putting some money in the bank and I'm locking it for 25 years. It's like a bank, or you imagine it as an LIC policy. So you're putting it in and that's for a fixed amount of time. And you know what is the rate of return government is giving you? It's 16%. Yes. 16% ROI. Return on investment you will get if you invest into a power plant. Okay. And that fixed cost, if you see for a unit power, for one unit which we use, is 1.5 rupees, something around. Okay. Now, when people started telling like 1 rupee, 2 rupee badh jayega, it can't happen, right? For the entire project to install that power plant and to run it for 25 years, it was just 1.5 rupees a unit. How will it suddenly become like, you know, 2 rupee or 3 rupee? So they will, then if you go into detail, nitty-gritty, then they will say, you know, whatever they invest, they want it in 3 years back. Which means, you know, the repayment, paisa badh jayega. So they'll tweak the figures as much they want to tell you that it's going to cost a bomb. But we have been telling the government that it'll be 30 to 35 paise a unit. And now when some plants, now today the current status of implementation is at least 40-45% of the plants are in the right direction. They're in some way to meet the norm. And when we see what their average price increase is, even less than this 30-35 paise a unit. And they'll tell you, oh my God, okay. Another beautiful example is, they said, you know, the technologies will not work for Indian coal. That was hilarious. Everyone were like, you know, it is a tried and tested technology world over, and coal plants are shutting in other parts of the world, and it's just in India and some, you know, Asian countries where coal is being used now. And the entire market is coming to India. And how will the, you know, there'll be no technology, and how can they make such absurd statements? But that is also one statement which is still getting floated around, saying, you know, technology nahi hai. Aap jo standards bolenge, wo to meet hi nahi hoga, because we don't have that kind of technology. You're giving something very absurd. But that's again not true. Now, another thing they say is timelines. You know, to do this, it'll take a long time. It'll take at least 5 years. It'll take 25 years. Different people give different time scales. Now, if you actually see a new, brand new power plant, people can build in 3 years, 4 years today. But these guys, to just put a small equipment there, they were negotiating. They were saying that, you know, it might take more than 5 years. So that's again a bullshit. So this is typically the time which will take. Construction time, once the agreement and everything is signed, this is all the time which it is going to take. And downtime is basically how much days you need to, you know, close the operation of the plant so that you can fit in the equipments properly. When the flue gas is coming out, obviously you can't join two tubes, so you need to close the plant. So that is about this. Yeah, non-feasibility, which I told you. That many generators keep saying it is technically unfeasible, but You know, it's a mature technology. It has been in operation for a long time. And China has done it in 3 years. Like from 14% to 63% penetration, they did it in 3 years. Now they have over 90% of their plants, everyone have FGD. China can do it, then India can also, yeah. So if you have any queries with regard to getting these norms implemented and including this into your, you know, your action plan, you can always contact us. And these are some of the briefs, publications which we have done over time since 2015 to see where the norms are and what best coal power plants can do to improve their performance in terms of emissions. Of course, ash is a big problem, and that's a complete different different one to, you know, tackle with. Saurabh?